Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John DeVita Broadcast Center on Jack FM 89.7, WRHS FM, Norwich, and the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network on Thursday, June the 11th. And now, here is Fred Belcastro. Good morning, sir.
Where am I?
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
and the whole world smiles with you,
smiles with you.
And when you're laughing,
when you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing,
and the sun comes shining through,
shining through.
When you're crying,
when you're crying,
you bring on the rain,
bring on the
stop
rain.
Your sighing,
stop your sighing.
Won't you be happy again,
happy again.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling.
Keep on smiling,
keep on smiling,
and the world will smile.
Good morning and welcome once again to the Wealth and Wisdom program. My name is Fred Belcastro, your host, and during the next half hour, we'll be talking about using smarts, using our wisdom, and protecting our growth and protecting our wealth and growth. As usual, we're broadcasting this morning from the John DeVita's Broadcast Center here on the northwest side of Chicago. And this program can also be heard during the next few months, during the month of June and July, on instead of Friday mornings at 10 a.m., it'll be at on Thursdays, 10 a.m. to 10:30. I'm sorry, 11 o'clock, 11 to 11:30. Let me write that down, make a note of it so that doesn't happen again, because it's going to be over the next 2 months, June and July, from 11 o'clock until 11:30. And that'll be broadcasted, as usual, on Jack FM, 89.7 WRHS out of Norwich. When talking about protecting and growing our wealth and using intelligence, our intelligence to protect and take care of what we already have, sometimes I think about how this is coming across and how individuals are accepting some of the advice I may be given. It's sometimes a little contrary to what you may have wanted or may have heard, but nevertheless, it's the truth as I've known it to be in the financial industry for the last 50 years. And in coming up with conceptual ideas on how to depict some of these concepts that I talk about, I'll go back to the standards that were used by an individual back in the 1950s, John Savage, or Don Blanton today, in drawing circles. So if we could just take a walk over to the blackboard and draw a big circle, and so that we have an idea of what I'm talking about. And in that circle, we'll cut it up, take chunks out of it like we would a piece of pie, and just look and label those chunks, because I want to talk about the three basic types of money that we have in our portfolios. All right, financial professionals are always interested in talking to us about what type of money. Well, when they call us on the phone, the first thing they want to know is how much money do we have? How much money is in the chunk of pie, in the chunk of our wealth, in the chunk of our money that we have accumulated? Now, this accumulation is the money that's in our bathtubs, in the freezer, in the drawers, mattresses, CDs, our qualified retirement plans, wherever we have money that's accumulated. And that's one of the three types of money. We have the accumulated dollars, and then we have the dollars that we spend for our lifestyle, you know, for the day-to-day living expenses. And then we have the money that we choose to talk about here. And that isn't very popular, because it's the transferred money. It's the money that we use to satisfy, for the most part, debt expense. This is the dollars that we're losing. And I say we're losing them unknowingly or unnecessarily. Perhaps we do know about them because if we didn't know about it, it would all be unnecessary expenditures. But some of these are, we don't realize what the chunks of money consist of. So we have our accumulated money, lifestyle money, and we have money that we're transferring away. But the financial professionals always talk to us about the accumulated money. And once they have an idea of the amount of money that we have, The second question that they'd have to ask would be, well, where is it now, Mr. Jones? Where do you have your money? And then you give me or give them a clear picture of how much you have. They'll say, where is it? And what type of products do you have that invested in? And of course, the conversation really goes to, well, we have a better program, or we have a better method. We use the Monte Carlo's simulation approach. We use the modern portfolio theory money, and we can come up with a better yield than what you're currently using. And that's what we talked about last week, about giving you a better product, or giving you a better bat, or giving you a better glove, or a better set of golf clubs. It's really not going to improve your game, whether it be golf or baseball, as compared to having the necessary skill, or having the skill of a Tiger Woods 15 years ago, or a batting champion. So unless we improve our skills, the products aren't going to make a whole lot of difference. And I'm going to let you in on something. If you bring almost any financial advisor a portfolio, he can improve on it. And he'll improve on it by using proprietary funds. If you look at an individual, and he'll tell you, I'm licensed through, these products are offered through, and it's generally a broker-dealer that sponsors a mutual fund company. If I'm working for a mutual fund company, where do you think the products are going to come from? They're going to come from the mutual fund company that I work for. If we do put in some outside funds, it's only to maybe diversify a little bit, but most of the money is going to go into these proprietary funds. Well, when you have a portfolio of funds, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 different investments or different mutual funds, you can always find one in your American funds or wherever funds are. You can always find one in the family of funds that's going to perform last year, the year before, a little better than what the client may have had the last couple of years. So you can always improve on it, but it's never a guarantee. It's like I said some time ago, it's like driving down the street looking in the rearview mirror. We're always looking at past performances, and we warn the individuals that there's no guarantee of the future. But so when we find out, well, where is it? What are you earning? And we say, well, our bat, our ball, our clubs, our products, our mutual funds, you can do better than that. Now, if you don't have any money accumulated, well, then the conversation's got to go to something like, well, if I could show you the best plan that you've ever had, and you be the judge of that, how much could you set aside regularly? Could you set aside $500 a month, $1,000 a month into this portfolio? And the reason is that we want to make it substantial, or the broker-dealer or the advisor wants to make it substantial. Otherwise, does he want to waste his time with somebody that has a minuscule amount? You'll listen to individuals on the radio, and they'll say that if you have a quarter of $1 million, we'll take a look at your portfolio. Or we'll put my 20 or 30 or 35, 40 years of experience, but you have to have a portfolio of a $500,000. Well, is that indicative of my skill or ability? It's more indicative of what I want to use as a commission basis. But anyway, that's getting into another area. And if you don't have any money to invest, or you can't save any more money, that's it. Adios, amigo, because we don't take your account. If I'm looking for accounts of $250,000 or $500,000, how about the fellow down the street that has $25,000 that wants to get a head start? What happens to that individual? If you don't have any money, you're not saving any money, you'll hear a click on the other end of that phone. What I'm getting to really is that very few individuals will talk to you about the transferred money problem, and I'll tell you why. It's not very romantic. You know, it's not a Stuart Granger and a Deborah Kerr chasing King Solomon's mines or Burma mine. It's nothing romantic. It's nothing exciting. It's the money problems that you're transferring away, and they exist because of debt management, debts that we might have, either debts with credit cards paying 18 to 20%, you know, each year on an annual. That's an awful lot of money. At an average balance of $10,000 at 20, you're paying $2,000 a year just in debt expense for that. How about a $30,000 automobile financed at 6? It's another couple of thousand, $1,800, I know, but another $2,000. That's $4,000. And when you add up all these things that we're paying, these revolving charges over at HIP or wherever it is that we have these accounts, the Discover and the various credit cards, we're paying close to at least $5,000 a year on just debt expense. Well, you know what? It's not a pleasant thing to go in and say, hey, we've got to dump this debt. I think it was last week. Did you see that horse race, the Triple Crown, when this American Pharoah just took it? I was watching the race, and it looked like he had the lead by about four lengths coming out of the stretch. It was a tremendous horse, tremendous lead. And I'm sure he had maybe a 110-pound jockey on his back. Well, I'm a little over 200 pounds. How about if I got on the horse's back? Do you think he'd run just as fast? Well, wait a second. You're a pretty strong guy. You're a pretty rugged individual. How about we started at the one end of the block, and I got up on your back, and you ran to the other end of the block. You think you could make it? You see, it becomes difficult. It becomes burdensome. It's a lot of drag. And that's what our expenses does on our finances. It's a big drag. So an individual comes to me and says, well, Fred, do you have something that I can invest my money in? I say, you know what? You just look at this individual and you say, does this individual want me to help them, or do they want me to sell them a product? Now, anybody can walk into Sports Mart and buy a set of golf clubs. Anybody could buy a bat and a ball, and you could get a Louisville Slugger that was endorsed by Ted Williams or clubs by Arnold Palmer. But is that really going to make you a professional? Are you going to be a turn pro, make the cut in the Masters because you have Arnold Palmer's clubs? Or am I going to get to the major leagues because I'm swinging Hank Aaron's bat? You know, it doesn't make any sense. And yet investment professionals just are constantly selling product. You're constantly taking stuff off the shelves, putting it or plugging it into a portfolio to make you look good. And if it doesn't materialize, well, you've got to give it time because we're all in it for the long haul. We were talking before, the long haul, my friends, as I say to people, in the long haul, we're all dead. You know, I'm not invested for the long haul. You're investing to maybe make some money. So I think what we've got to do is just to unchain ourselves, just release the kind of thinking that we're doing, and break those chains that hold us. And they actually hold us back.
Oh, my love, my darling, I've hungered for your touch a long, lonely time. Time goes by so slowly, and time can do so much. Oh, you still mine. I need your love. I need your love. God, speed your love to me. Lonely rivers flow to the sea, to the open arms of the sea. Lonely rivers sigh, wait for me, wait for me. I'll be coming home, wait for me. Oh, my love, my darling, I've hungered for your touch a long, long time. Time goes by so slowly, and time can do so much, or you still more, and I need your love, I need your love, God, speed your love to me.
Several years ago, in a restaurant, that song was playing, and I asked the people sitting at our table, who did that song? Who popularized it? And everyone said, oh, that was the Righteous Brothers. Everyone knows that the Righteous Brothers did the Unchained Melody. I couldn't get anyone to say Al Hibbler, because it was Al Hibbler in 1955 that brought that song up to the charts. 1955, Al Hibbler, who passed away just a few years ago, 10, 15 years ago, and at the time was living in Chicago. A blind individual that sang, I think, for about 8 years with Duke Ellington's band, made over 70 recordings, and that's the only one that became real popular. And speaking about popular and popularity, when I sit here and I say, when I started in this business 50 years ago, the first thing I said to people was, save your money. And that's a popular expression, but few people are doing it. And I say, stop the debt. Dump the debt. Get rid of your expenses. Get rid of those finance charges. And yet, people still carry them. And then several weeks ago, I came up with stopping the bleeding. When you see portfolio after portfolio after portfolio and household after household after household giving up way $4,000, $6,000, $8,000 a year in today's dollars just to satisfy debt service, you say, oh my gosh, if we could put that money and even save a couple of percent of that money, we would be way ahead, way ahead. There's no doubt that it's exciting to buy a new set of golf clubs with Father's Day coming up now. I see clubs are advertised on television. We can buy new shoes and sporting goods and of all kinds, and that's exciting, and that's something that we all enjoy. And it's fun to do those things. But when we look at our finances and we look at portfolios, we don't necessarily want to spend time on strategy, or if I start talking about dumping the debt. And listen, as a planner, I'll help you. I help people get rid of this debt, because that should be one of our primary focuses. Listen, first thing I do is talk to people about the debt and to give young people, when I prepare their taxes, anyone under 50 years old, I give them a portfolio showing them what they're spending in debt, and how we could just cut that down, save a little bit of taxes, save a little bit of the debt expense, and help them make some progress in their savings. Listen, it makes sense to me. For the last years and years and years, ever since I was an adult, to start with the money that individuals are losing before we try to focus on what's the best buy in the market. That's what focusing on transferred dollars is really all about. But listen, don't get the wrong impression. I didn't mean to give people the wrong impression last week. I can help you with all three types of money. But which one would you really like us to start spending our time discussing? How you could get an extra 1% or 2% that maybe not even going to make a big difference in your portfolio? Or worrying about some of the monies that we're transferring away unknowingly, unnecessarily, even either in our debt or in our taxes, and the way we handle our mortgages, the way we fund our retirement plans. It's a lot of ways to fill up that bucket. We talked at the beginning of the program. We were here from the John DeVito Broadcast Center maybe about 7-8 months ago, and we started talking about the transfer dollars and putting some of these savings plan in our bathtub. If we can go to the blackboard just once again, very quickly, let's put a bucket up there. Did you ever go downstairs and get that bucket, wash the floors, or use a mop, or anything like that? We've got a bucket, so let's take that bucket. And let's put all of our money into the bucket. I know I went from a circle to a bucket, but just bear with me. It's easier for me to say a bucket, because I think you can get the idea. And what we're gonna do in that bucket is we got some holes in the bucket. Holes are taxes. Do we spend money? Does some of our money go to taxes? All right. Does some of our money go to opportunity costs? Remember the opportunity costs? Along with the other erosion factors that I talk week after week after week. They're not romantic. They're nothing's going to tickle our ears with these kind of terms. Not like, you know, making 20 or 30 or 40% and doubling your money and all those kinds of bits of nonsense that you might hear. But just good, sound financial planning, financial wisdom. All right, we've got holes, opportunity costs that take money out of our bucket. We've got taxes that take money out of our bucket. We have interest expenses taking money out of our bucket. How much interest expenses are going out? Well, we said maybe 34% of every dollar. Remember when we started this? And we said just as an exercise in your own funds, figure it up. Put a dollar amount, not the percentage, but the dollar amount of the interest that we spend each year. We said, well, it comes out to about 34% of our gross take-home pay. And we're putting 34% out in debt expense, okay? Interest expense, in other words, the opportunity cost on that, would be about whatever the market is, 2 or 3% that we can get in guaranteed money now, maybe 1 or 2%, whatever that case is, that's what you're spending in addition to the interest expense, all right? What are we paying on our taxes? Not the marginal rate, but the overall rate, 19, 20, 22% of our gross income is going on taxes. Now, wait a second. Before we sit down and say, let me take on more risk with my family's money and my money, let me take on more risk by getting 1 or 2 or 5% more of my invested, not the total amount of my take-home pay, but my investable surplus away from my lifestyle, is it going to be worth it? Is that 4 or 5% additional money on our investments going to make a difference? And where am I going to get the money? If I'm already spending all this money in taxes, all the money in opportunity costs, all the money on debt expense, interest expense, where am I going to get the money? Well, what am I going to tell my kids? No vacation? No camp? You know, no lessons, no piano lessons, no music lessons during the summer. We can't afford it. I got to save more. Or am I going to, wealth and wisdom, am I going to use a little bit of more of wisdom and say, let's sit down and see what percentage we are paying that's unnecessary. How can we best eliminate that? How can we best fill up the bucket with our money? First of all, let's plug some of those holes. By plugging up the holes, the bucket just by the nature is going to fill up a lot faster. We don't have to put so much money in. We don't have to worry about taking on additional risk. Maybe we could just save what we've got. Maybe that'll be enough. We could start by eliminating the debt expense, by dumping the debt, by becoming free, by clearing our minds, worrying about the credit card payments and interest expenses and all these bills that we just compound and compound unnecessarily. First of all, let me tell you, the first thing, address your debt. The interest costs that accompany it, the taxes that keep us from putting money into our bucket. And if we have to save more, why take it from the lifestyle? Why don't we save the money that we're putting on and giving away free to other people? Once we've looked at these major issues, once we've satisfied these holes, plugged the holes in our bucket, pouring money into the bucket will begin to really have an impact on our saving potential, our wealth potential. listen, let's not just go to the products and buy bats and buy clubs and think that we're going to be making the cut into the Masters tournaments or getting on first base. We're not going to get on first base. That's why. How can we make it to the end of the block with an extra 200-pound guy on our back? Let's just take a break now and stop looking for these magic numbers, these magic products.
I'm gonna find her.
That was a very popular song back in 1957 called Searching, and it was done by the Coasters. The Coasters' 1957 7 hit. Well, our time, before we run out of time, let me just mention next week I'd like to talk about the minimum amount of dollars that we should be saving, where we're going to get that money, and you know by now it's going to be a reduction of taxes, money that we're needlessly sending in on taxes. The government wants their fair share, and they're entitled to it. We pay our taxes, and we pay everything that's due. But some of us make mistakes on how we handle some of these products that we're buying off the shelves. And then, of course, with that savings, what percentage of that saving on our debt service can go back to increasing our lifestyle? Because when I talk to families, I just don't say, well, how are we going to reduce the quality of our life so we can save more? We'll take it away from the people that are using these expenses on us and give it back to our families. Beginning of the show, I knew I was going to say something about this. I read an article in the paper, the Chicago papers, last week concerning a question that was sent in to an expert concerning the Social Security benefits. Their advice was to delay receiving Social Security until they're 70, and it would certainly be be more than they'd get at 62 or 65. Oh my God, such vanilla. But nevertheless, that's true. But that's not how you can get the maximum amount out of your Social Security. Husband and wife, there's switch strategies, and restricted applications where you can restrict the amount of dollars that you're getting on your Social Security, take your spousal benefits, enjoy a cash flow and income, increased income right now. Then at age 70, go right back into your own, take what you would have gotten anyway. That's how you increase it. But you've got to look into it. You've got to do something about it. If you have any questions about anything we're discussing, give me a call, 630-673-4360, or send an email, fbellsecure@aol.com. All right, folks, time is up. Be kind to one another. Let's set a goal next week of making someone smile, doing something good for somebody, and taking care of everyone. Have a great week. Thanks for listening. Thanks for the phone calls and suggestions. All right. Till next week, have a good week. Make somebody smile.
When you're smiling.
When you're smiling.
When you're smiling.
When you're smiling.
And the whole world smiles with you.
Smiles with you.
And when you're laughing.
When you're laughing.
Oh, you're laughing.
Oh, you're laughing.
Mm. When the sun comes shining through,
shining through.
When you're crying,
when you're crying,
you bring on the rain. Stop your sighing,
stop your
sighing. Won't you be happy again?
Happy again.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
keep on smiling,
keep on smiling,
and the world will smile.
You have been listening to Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John DeVita Broadcast Center. On Jack FM 89.7, WRHS FM Norwich, and Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network on Thursday, June 11th, the year 2015. This broadcast was directed by John DeVita. Our special thanks to radio station manager Kevin Zeflik of WRHS FM Norwich and the executive producer of Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network, Mr. John Chikanda. Until next time, please be safe and thanks for listening. This broadcast was pre-recorded on Wednesday, June the 10th, the year 2015. Have a good day, everyone. And this is Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM, Norwich, Illinois.